By the end of this video, I want you to ruin my idea. Yes, you heard me right. I need your constructive critics. With all the experience and background you have, tell me why this idea won't work in your city. Hey everyone, and welcome to my channel, where we talk about urban development process and what make our cities look and function the way they do. 5 years ago, man, I'm getting old. Together with my classmate Juliana, we faced a competition challenge of revitalizing a monofunctional district in Harlem. We just graduated and have plenty of time for these kind of adventures. So, this district, Schalkwijk-Midden, was not able to adapt to contemporary demand, and municipality wanted to make a master plan for the whole neighborhood. But since the beginning, I couldn't get rid of one thought. How can we impose a top-down master plan for the district with more than 10 owners? And if I'm not mistaken, municipality was not among them. Anyways, they wanted to have a master plan and then somehow convince the owners to change their plots accordingly. Well, for the modernist urban planners who work for the authorities with dictators' ambitions, this wouldn't be a problem. But we can dictate owners how, when, and what they should change in their plots. Before we continue, I have to remind you about likes, subscription, shares, and so on. Then I recall two things. First, the games on land value capture, and then that in some countries the land ownership is separated from the development rights. Also, that it's possible to exchange them. I will make sure to add some links to the research papers in the description below. Now let me illustrate it for you, because I know that in the beginning this idea sounds quite abstract. Imagine that you have a plot, but it doesn't mean that you're allowed to build something on it, or dig something out of it, or even cut a tree. These all are development rights which you get from the local municipality. In literature, you will find it as a bundle of development rights and responsibilities. Now imagine that you own the land without any development rights. I bet it won't cost much. But let's assume that because of some zoning changes or whatever reasons, municipality gave you some extra development rights, and this will immediately influence the value of your property. Now what do we have here? Without any effort from your side, your asset or potential income increase. Not bad, huh? But actually it's not fair, because somebody in municipality did this job for you. In the corrupt countries, this will balance with bribing.
Dear Mr. Tkachenko, please have a look on our drawings. We plan to build 10 more floors there, but I believe you know what to do in this situation, don't you?
In other countries, they use land value captures for this. In other words, if municipality actions cause the increase of the value of your property, they will take a part of this margin via taxes or other tools. That's fair, no? I believe you all understand that in our fast-changing world, not always the current set of your development rights will suit your needs. For example, let's assume that you have a plot and you're allowed to build two stories on it. Well, actually, you decide that you want only one, while your neighbor wants to build three-story building. Well, in this case, you can sell him the right of one floor. In literature, they call it transfer of development rights.
But basically, you're selling the area above you.
The second thought was about Almere Osterwald. Local landowners had to develop their plots within particular functional balance. In other words, their plots were strictly divided by functions in percentage equivalent. They didn't call it development rights or responsibilities, but by its nature it was exactly a representation of this theory. It was massively marked as an extremely flexible approach. Nevertheless, the local people I interviewed for my master's thesis research said that this approach worked well for the rectangular shapes, while in their experience it didn't really work for irregular shapes. It was almost impossible to make cohesive infrastructure and still stick to that simple rules. With this in mind, I started thinking, how to encourage the owners to develop within the common vision and at the same time keep it fair. How to give them a possibility to adapt for the market needs and give them possibility to develop in their own pace. Like, how to do it?
No, it's impossible. The landowners are greedy rich bastards. Well, one wise man said that we will never solve the issue with the mindset that created it.
Together with my friend, we believe that we could achieve it with the shifting focus from the design to development process. Yeah, by the end of the day, your beautiful drawings are not the main goal. They're just one of the tools to achieve this development process. Nowadays, many projects use participatory tools to involve stakeholders on the early stages and create shared vision. We've spoken about it in the previous videos and you can check the playlist somewhere there. Now we decide to focus on tools that make this common vision happen. And as you probably already guessing, we choose developing rights and responsibility to do so, which encourage the owners develop their land and at the same time secure some common goods. And by unlocking the development rights from the land ownership as it's done in Latin America and USA, we can introduce more investment tools. For the project in Schalkwijk, we propose to set up a baseline where new development rights distributed proportionally among the land owners. And then to bridge the gap with the land value capture, these development rights would be complemented with development responsibilities.
We all remember that with great power, aka rights, comes responsibilities, don't we?
However, after introducing of all the things we've just mentioned, the project can face the following challenges. Let's imagine scenario A, where commerce developing rights distributed proportionally among all the owners. They would be definitely happy, and because it's fair, but this won't suit businesses that prefer to cluster. And then in scenario B, where we redistribute these commerce development rights according to market needs or some urban planning assumptions, the businesses will be happy, but some of the owners definitely not. The same will apply when you will redistribute the development responsibilities. If you want to create efficient networks, it doesn't always reflect the plot capacities as it happened in Elmera Osterwald. To face the complexity and at the same time keep it fair for the landowners, we propose to let them exchange and trade these rights and responsibilities, simply as it done with CO2 emissions between countries. Later, municipality can track these transactions to just keep up and see the current situation, and owners can use it to make sure that they earn the fair profit. We also believe that it can help the future users to become co-creators.
Now tell me, what could possibly go wrong with this idea if it would be implemented in your city? Yes. Let's crash this idea in the comments below, and I promise you to make another video based on your thoughts as soon as we get enough input.
Thank you, and that's it for now. Ciao!